Hi, my name is Dr. Ola Brown, GP at HealthCap Africa. HealthCap Africa is my second fund. It's focused on fintech and healthtech. And one of the things that I've done that's quite unique about our fund is we've actually warehoused as a team over 10 portfolio companies in fintech and healthtech over the past 3 years to put into the fund at the same cost that we bought into them 3 years ago. And I'm looking forward to Blessing answering asking me some questions that we are frequently asked by investors about HealthCap Africa, about the VC asset class, and about our team.
Thank you, Dr. Ola, for that brief introduction. So can you explain the venture capital asset class and its benefits?
So venture capital is the asset class that focuses on investing in high growth, high scale, mostly technology oriented ventures. And that's different from public equities, which you see on the Nigerian Stock Exchange or the NASDAQ. These are already mature companies that tend to grow slower. You see the real estate asset class, for example, where you buy real estate. Again, it's not as fast growing. Everybody knows the price. There's not so much asymmetry. I think it's most similar actually to the private equity asset class. But even then, private equity investors tend to invest in much more mature companies than venture capital. Venture capital is the asset class that funded Uber, that funded Google, that funded Airbnb, that funded Stripe. And it focuses on these really fast-growing, super innovative companies that have potential for national, continental, or global scale.
How does venture capital investing differ from other investment strategies?
So I think that venture capital is sort of, you won't get the kind of returns that you get in venture capital anywhere else. So it's very rare for any asset class to give you the kind of returns profile that you get in venture capital. Because like I said, we're investing early stage, we're taking the most risk, and we're investing in the companies when they're basically sort of in their infancy. And one that sort of trajectory, that velocity of growth that comes when you're investing in an early stage company and you're following it right up to maturity and exit is a really rapid stage of growth, right? That's why they're called startups. And I think that that's where it differs from other asset classes like venture capital, like real estate, and obviously like investing in government bonds, where you kind of know how much you're going to make when you're making the investment. So a government bond, for instance, might have a face value of say, or a coupon rate of say 7%. So you know that you're going to make 7% on that investment, and you're not going to make any more, and you're not going to make any less, unless something terrible happens. And it has happened where people have invested in so-called reliable government bonds and, you know, the country has defaulted and they've lost all their money. But generally speaking, with other asset classes in the fixed income category, you kind of know how much you're going to make. With equity, you have the potential for higher returns, and VC is sort of at the end of that spectrum where it gives you the potential for the highest possible returns.
What kind of returns can limited partners expect from investing in venture capital?
Like I said, it's a high risk, high return asset class. So, with these kind of stable government bonds or sort of savings accounts, or you kind of know to some extent that it's sort of guaranteed. Not always, and especially as we've experienced in Africa, we've invested in so-called stable investments that haven't really panned out. But there's a lot more stability than you sort of would find in other asset classes in the fixed income category. When you move into equities, when you move into owning a share of those companies, then you are a shareholder. It's, you know, you have a piece of that company, and any upside that the company makes during its growth trajectory, you get a piece of that upside, which is very, very different from when you invest in, I'm in Nigeria, so I would say the Nigerian Eurobond. Whereas no matter how much Nigeria grows during the time that you hold Nigeria's bond, they will still give you the same interest rate. Even if Nigeria grew up 200%, which is impossible, but let's just wild example, right? You will still collect the face value of that coupon, and you can't say, oh, Nigeria, you made so much money and you're only giving me 6%. That was what was agreed at the beginning of the investment. Whereas in a venture capital investment, if it grows 200%, you get part of that upside. And that's why people are so excited about investing in venture capital. It's also an asset class that focuses on young people. So most of the startups that you see are created by people under the age of 44. Young people are coming up with, you know, fantastic ideas around the continent, and we give them the capital to help them grow.
Why focus on Africa, and what opportunities does the continent present?
That's a really fantastic question. So I'm super excited about Africa because I moved to Nigeria from Japan. Japan is one of the slowest growing countries in the world. In Japan, they sell more adult diapers than children's diapers. So imagine the difference when I moved here and saw, you know, the most rapidly growing population in the entire world. By 2100, Nigeria alone, in terms of population, will be bigger than China. By 2100, Africa's population will be 10 times bigger than China. And that means all of these people need to consume, they need to eat, they need to wear clothes, they need to go out, they need to rent accommodation, they're going to go to school. So you can imagine the growth of the market. It's the most exciting market I can think of right now. In addition to this, we have special talents, right? I think the creation of fintech products and banking products are the superpower of African young people. So when you think of the first digital currencies, when you think about the transactions of mobile monies, when you think about how transactions will be done in the future and the future of money, I really, really think that Africa will be leading that push. 70% of all mobile money transactions are already done on the continent. And when you think about some of our great fintech unicorns, like Flutterwave, for instance, that's about to list on the NASDAQ for a valuation, or its last valuation was worth $3 billion. When you think about companies like Paystack, which I invested in back in 2016, that grew from a valuation of $1 million when we invested $200 million when it was acquired by Stripe. These are stories of African innovation that show that we have a comparative and competitive advantage, I think, in the fintech asset class or the fintech sector. And I think that this is super exciting for any investor. So I've spoken about the population, I've spoken about the level of innovation, I've spoken about our comparative and competitive advantage in fintech. And now I'm going to speak about why I'm so excited about health tech. I think that the same sort of accelerated innovation that we saw in fintech can happen in health tech. And Africa currently has the worst healthcare outcomes in the world, even compared to countries in LATAM or in Asia that have similar GDP per capita. And I think that we've done it so well in banking and fintech that there's a real opportunity for us to do it again in health tech and create solutions for healthcare that not only benefit Africans, but actually can be exported to the rest of the world, reducing the cost of healthcare and adding not just years to our lives, but life to our years.
Can you share your track record in venture capital investing?
So this is my second fund. My first fund was started in the 2016 vintage. It achieved a 5x DPI, which is made it one of the highest performing funds, not just in Africa, but in the world. We had a generalist perspective before, so we were focusing on every sector. So you can imagine me sort of investing in an agri-tech one day and a logistics tech the next day and a climate tech the next day and a media tech the next day. But for this fund, we've decided to specialize because we know that there's good evidence that specialist funds outperform generalist funds. So we're focused on the two things that I feel that myself and my team are really good at, which is fintech and health tech. I'm a medical physician by training. I founded and ran one of the largest emergency services companies in West Africa. I hold a master's in finance where I focused on fintech, and I'm just finishing off my PhD in finance, which also focuses on fintech and financial innovation. So these are the areas where we think we can really, really compete. We can add value to founders, and we can approach each sector with this sense of deep subject matter expertise, which helps us add value in really unique ways.
Can you share your team's experience and how their expertise aligns with the fund's strategy?
When we were recruiting our team, we thought about two things. We wanted deep subject matter expertise and we wanted operational experience. In terms of operational experience, we wanted people that had worked in the sector before. So instead of going for traditional investment bankers, we actually went for people that were working in the investment sector or working in venture capital but had a background in things like pharmacy or lab scientists and had worked in those sectors before. Because I think to be able to relate to founders, it's easier for somebody that has been in an operational business and operated a business at an executive level to be able to relate to founders and help them solve their problems, particularly in the early stages. So that's in terms of the operational experience and the subject matter expertise of the team that we've recruited. I'm assisted by a principal, a venture partner, and a team of analysts, about 11 of us in total, who are all focused on helping these early stage founders scale their companies across Africa and to the rest of the world.
What sets your fund apart from others in the venture capital space?
I think there's a load of things that sets us apart from other people. And I'd say the first thing is really that deep subject matter expertise that our team has that really sets us apart in these two sectors that we invest. I also think that our track record, I can't think of a single fund in Africa that has returned 5 times money to investors. And if we've done it before, there's a high likelihood that we can do it again. And that's really exciting and something that I'm quite proud of. I also think that we've taken risks that other fund managers don't. I personally put in enough money to warehouse 10 companies in preparation for this fund. So anybody that invests in this fund will be getting 10 companies at the prices that they were a few years ago. So we've effectively de-risked the fund using our own capital, whereas most funds you find have nothing in them and they don't have any warehoused companies to put into the fund or very few warehoused companies to put into the fund. So it's not as de-risked as our asset, where some of the companies that we've invested in have grown almost 10 times since the initial stage of investment, and we're still putting them into the fund at the cost they were at that time.
What unique value proposition do you offer limited partners?
I think I've just spoken about that actually in my last question, where I spoke about our deep subject matter expertise, I spoke about our track record, I spoke about our warehouse portfolio where people are basically making a profit on entry to the fund, which isn't typically the case. And I've also spoken about our team, which is quite unique in terms of their sector expertise and their operational experience. But one thing I didn't speak about is actually the impacts that we make. And I think that that's something that people are looking for. I think that in Africa, we're at the stage where a lot of investors don't just want to make money, but they want to understand the impact. And we have a very sort of specialist approach to measuring impact in terms of the number of patients reached, in terms of the number of female founders that we support, in terms of the number of people that become financially included as a result of our products, and really mapping the impact to the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals that were pioneered by the UN.
What is your investment thesis and strategy of the fund?
So our investment thesis is to invest in early stage companies, so pre-series A. Series A is an institutional round of capital when big investors come in. Pre-series A is the earlier stages where it's dominated by early stage venture funds. So we invest in early stage companies and we invest in two sectors, fintech and healthtech, and we invest across Nigeria, Kenya, Egypt and South Africa, the 4 big economies of Africa that make up over 50% of Africa's GDP and 60% of the consumer class.
How will limited partners be updated on fund performance and progress?
We do a quarterly report to all our limited partners where they see the revenue, margins, and impact metrics of every single company that we've invested in. And we also hold a yearly AGM. And our AGMs were really, in my first fund, were really fun because we used to get guest speakers to talk about the economy or to talk about sort of foreign policy. So we had some really interesting speakers for our AGMs, and we're going to continue that with fund 2. So I hope I've answered some of the questions about the venture capital asset class, its impact, and why you should be thinking about investing with us. If you have any further questions, I'm available on my email, and I'm sure you have the team's emails as well. And I look forward to working with you to create a healthier, wealthier Africa.